Stay tuned for the Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's Interview, the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. Our guests today are actors Joe Hernandez-Kolski and Hiroyuki Sanada. Actor-writer Joe Hernandez-Kolski was born and raised in Chicago. He graduated from Princeton, which is a pretty heavy-duty college. Were you going to act when you went there?
I went to Princeton because it was just a great opportunity for me. And I didn't go there looking for, I didn't go there looking to major in theater. But it was funny because I was such the overachiever in high school doing, I was like the class president. I was going to Whitney Young Magnet High School in Chicago. I said to myself, when I get away to college, I'm just gonna focus on my grades. Princeton's gonna be really intense. I'm not doing any theater. I spend way too much time there. And I auditioned for the first play 2 weeks into being there and got the lead in it. And before I knew it, that's all I did.
You couldn't stand it. But you were acting as a child in Chicago.
Yeah, I started acting when I was about 6 years old.
How did that happen?
It's funny, and this is still, the more you change, the more you stay the same as you go throughout life.
The more you change.
You're the exact same person, Joan, who you were when you were a little girl. And I was watching my mom in a play, and I was 6 years old, and I still have the image in my head. I was sitting in the front row, and I was watching all of them, and I said, I can do that. I want to do that. I want to be up there. And so my mother said to me, and this is the whole way I was raised, was I said, Mom, I want to be in the play. And she said, well, you have to go talk to Mr. Brubaker over there. He's the director. And I said, I'm 6 years old, and she said, this is what you do. You say, hi, Mr. Brubaker, my name is Joey Kolski, I'd like to be in your play. So she pushes me off, and I, the six-year-old, go pulling this guy's shirt and ask him if I can be in his play. And I pretty much haven't stopped acting since then.
Well, I was gonna ask you what your big break was. I think that was the big break,
that was it.
The six-year-old.
I was 6 years old doing Here's Love, the musical version of Miracle on 34th Street.
Is that right?
Yeah, that's what I was doing.
And your mother was acting then?
She was acting. It was community theater, and that's how she got her kicks, and she still loves acting.
She still loves the theater. I sat with her during the play that you were in at the Kirk Douglas Theater at the Stones, and she loves the theater. We talked about New York theater. Mm-hmm. We talked about Chicago theater, so I know she's interested, and I wondered how difficult it was for her to be a mother watching her child on the stage.
She's somebody referred to her yesterday as my momager. And and she's always wanted to manage my career. And I told her I don't want her to. I want her to live her life, focus her life on what she wants to do. But she loves what I do. And the Stones was really exciting for me. Because after the play, she said this was the first time she's ever seen her son. She's ever seen me perform, and she forgot I was her son.
Well, you were a teenager.
I played a 15-year-old.
So you convinced her, even convinced me, at the end when she finally told me that that was her son. She'd never told me before. I said, well, how old is he?
Yeah.
And she said, in his 30s. And yeah. I said, no, he looks like a teenager. Well, let's talk about that a little bit, mm-hmm. because how'd you get in shape for that? You were on a skateboard the whole time, climbing. And
I'm blessed to have done that show, because now my body just is jonesing for physical activity every day. It's so used to the intense work we did. Because for those who don't know, The Stones was directed by Corey Madden at the Kirk Douglas Theater as part of the Center Theater Group's new series there. And it was choreographed by Jacques Haim, who...
Well, it was definitely choreographed.
Who's from Cirque du Soleil and Diavolo.
Right.
And he's this man who comes up with, let's try doing this, And before you know it, you're doing flips and stuff. And he's just
And you were hanging on things.
We were hanging,
scaling the walls.
Everything.
How did you get to keep your stamina up? That's
yoga.
What worried. What?
Yoga.
Did you?
Yeah, I do yoga 3 times a week. And
so after the show, would you like kind of meditate or?
After the show, we would collapse on the floor. I mean,
you were.
We would walk off stage.
When you got your final curtain, I think you were like dead, weren't you?
It's the most intensely physical show ever, and hopefully one of these days, maybe it'll come back. And
give us the story really quickly, because I want to talk about your hip hop stuff and all the other stuff you do.
So briefly, The Stones was a show that was two actors, 4 characters, and we play the teenagers who are creating havoc on a Sunday afternoon. They're bored, they don't know what to do, and they decide, well, let's throw. We're walking over a freeway overpass, and we say, I bet you can't hit that car. And so before we'd know it, we're trying to hit the car. We end up causing a major accident, which leads to huge ramifications. And then we also play the two detectives who are investigating the case. So in front of the audience's eyes, we change between being, I'm the 15-year-old, he's the 13-year-old, and then the adult detectives.
I know, it's amazing. It's so great, but I think the Kirk Douglas, all of the work there is so wonderful. Center Theater Group really has a great thing going there. Well, now, you played that, but you also do stand-up. After you finished that, you sent me some emails about being in New York.
I just got back from New York.
What was that? You want a piece of me?
You want a piece of me. That's my solo show.
Okay, what is
it's
that?
It's me. What it is, it's my personal story told through several different small pieces. It's primarily spoken word and comedy and storytelling with a lot of dance.
You call yourself a spoken word poet. What does that mean?
So, I first and foremost consider myself an actor. That's what I grew up as. When I moved out to L.A., I did a lot of ensemble theater with like Zoo District and Sacred Fools and several other different theaters, East L.A. Classics. But I was doing all of this group work, so I wanted to make sure that I was also working on my own material and getting a chance to share what my point of view was. So what I started doing, I had been writing poetry since I was a kid. I started writing these pieces that I wanted to get out there. I was doing all of this theater where people would go, your scene was so good. You know, and it's just 1 5-minute scene in a 2.5-hour play with 18 other actors. So I started jonesing to get my own material out there. So I started writing it, and you go to open mics. And now what spoken word poetry is, it's this, I don't want to say a new term because it's been around forever. You know, Gil Scott-Heron and the Lost Poets and the Watts Prophets have all made it popular in the 60s.
They use that word, spoken word.
But what
poetry.
It is, it's spoken word is really the combination of poetry and performance, and you put it together.
Oh, I see. So then you went on to do deaf poetry, and were you a part of that show?
So I was on the season finale of deaf poetry, I guess now. Not this last season, but the season before that.
And did you write your own material?
Absolutely.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
And then when you do You Want a Piece of Me, that shows that you're an actor, you're a poet, you're a performer. So you have little vignettes of all those things?
I was doing a show called The Bomedy of Errors, which is a hip-hop version of Shakespeare's Comedy of Errors that was created by five kids in New York about 3 or 4 years ago. I was lucky enough to get cast in that, and we took it from Florida to Chicago to the Edinburgh Festival in Scotland.
You did all these fringe festivals, right?
Amazing. It was so amazing. It's so much fun. It's such a, for anyone who loves theater, have you ever?
I've been to Fringe Festival. I think it's great.
Have you ever been to the Edinburgh one?
No, I want to.
1,500 shows per day being performed all throughout the city. And we were lucky enough that we were a part of one of the larger shows. So we had 300 people packed into this hot, humid church space.
What was that?
What?
Bombardy?
The Bombardy of Errors.
Okay.
So I was doing
like
that
the
show.
The Comedy of Errors, yeah.
It's the Comedy of Errors, but it's one DJ, 4 actors, over 20 characters, and 72 costume changes.
But how do you know hip hop? I mean, is it your background?
I know hip-hop? I grew up, and this is all in my solo show, I grew up in Chicago, very much inundated with a lot of different cultural aspects. I was hip hop and house music and the culture were all around me. But because I was a natural born rebel, like I'm not trying to say like, yeah, I'm a rebel, but I was a metalhead. I grew up listening to heavy metal.
Oh, so that's why it was the next.
So I didn't want anything to do with it. But it was when I went away to Princeton and went through this major culture shock that I learned to grab onto that, which to me was most familiar.
So did you identify as a Latino? Because you're Hernandez-Kolski.
As I grew up very ironically. I'm a soy Chicano y Polaco de Chicago.
See,
I'm half Polish,
it?
Half Mexican, speak fluent Spanish now. But when I was 12, I had serious cultural identity. And so it was my mom sending me to Mexico City to live with my family down there. That was like the first huge landmark for me. But growing up, I didn't identify with it at all.
That's what I wondered.
And it's only over the years that I've learned to really identify with a lot of my different roots, whether it's hip-hop and house music, which I now
you
love,
feel like a part of, right?
Which is a part of me. But when I was growing up, I wanted nothing to do with it. The same way with my Mexican background. I come from a very strong political family and very strong female family.
Strong women.
A lot of aunts. My mother, very strong Mexican household run by the women. And don't let my uncles hear that. But my grandfather passed away when my mom was 13 and was raised by my grandmother, who was the first Mexican-American politician in the city of Chicago.
Matriarchal. Very matriarchal. But, and before we leave, because I want to touch on this downbeat 720, because that fits into what we're talking about, doesn't it? Tell us a little bit about that.
So, I'm lucky enough that I have a good career as an actor where, you know, my short film is going to the New York Latino Film Fest in a couple weeks. I just got back from performing my solo show in New York, and I'm developing a feature script now. I have the ability to run Downbeat 720 or host it, which is this open mic for high school youth.
Which is so great because you're teaching. You're also a teacher, so this is helping you teach them and have this open mic. And who comes to that?
It's high school kids from all over the city. And to me it's so important right now that kids have a place to express their views, really take a chance. It is not easy getting up on a stage, but if I can share the opportunity that I had when I was 6 years old, if I can share that and get pass that on to someone so that they can get over their fears early on.
Can you help coach them?
Absolutely.
So because I know as part of your workshops that you give, is that where that workshopping helps at the Downbeat 720?
Absolutely.
Oh, it does. Oh.
So, and we're blessed that the open mic runs twice a month, and it's in Santa Monica. And
the city runs it,
which
is fabulous.
The city sponsors it. Justin Yoff from Cultural Affairs. It was his idea.
So great.
It went so well that Downbeat Showdown started airing. We had two seasons of that. We just got nominated for an Emmy in youth programming.
And in 2000, you got an NAACP award for choreography?
Correct.
So you're a dancer, you're a skateboarder, you're an actor, you're a hip-hop.
Not a skateboarder.
Oh my gosh.
I'm not a skateboarder, but I play one on stage.
Oh boy, if you weren't a skateboarder, I don't know what you were.
Yeah, no, I just make it look easy.
You made it look great. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you so much, Joan.
Thank you. And thanks for watching this part of the show. Don't go away because we're going to have Hiroyuki Sanada on in a second.
We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome back to the Joan Quinn Profiles. We're back with an interview which was taped on location of Hiroyuki Sanada, who is an internationally celebrated stage actor who starred in Romeo and Juliet in Japan and with the Royal Shakespeare Company's production of King Lear in London. On the screen, we saw him in The Last Samurai with Tom Cruise and the 2004 Oscar-nominated film The Twilight Samurai, directed by Yoji Yamada. And he was also in the Merchant Ivory production of The White Countess with Ralph Fiennes and Vanessa Redgrave. We're going to talk to him about all the things that we just heard, and as well as his role in Chen Kaiga's monumental film, The Promise.
Duke.
Do they? Duke, I know. How'd you get all those names?
I don't know. I never know that.
I thought maybe you did.
I was surprised when I saw this poster.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So you have all these different names, but we know you as Hiroyuki Sanada.
Hiroyuki, yeah.
Is that right? Hiroyuki.
Yeah, please call me Hiro.
Okay, Hiro. You're equally at home on stage and on the screen. In Japan in 1987, you performed Romeo and Juliet, and it was directed by that kabuki master, Tomasaburo,
yeah.
Tomasaburo.
Yes.
Who is, in fact, one of the top people in Japan, no?
Top kabuki actor.
Did you study the classics in Japan?
Yeah, I've learned traditional Japanese dance and some no theater and a little bit kabuki.
But did you study Shakespeare?
Yeah, never before because we don't have any class for the Shakespeare at the school, you know. So after I started the theater acting, I started to studying the translated Shakespeare, you know. Oh,
did you do it in Japanese?
Yes, Romeo and Hamlet I've done in Japanese.
Oh,
and
I
then
didn't
the Fool in King Lear, it was my first experience speaking English on stage in front of the London audiences.
Your work in the Royal Shakespeare Company's King Lear was so brilliant that the Queen made you an MBE, which is a member of the British Empire, right?
Yeah, I was so surprised.
Well, is it an exception? I thought it was just for British subjects. You're not British subject, are you?
Because, you know, I've done Shakespeare play with the RSC, and then I stayed in London and Stratford for a long time. And then I continued the relationship between British and Japanese theater. So that's why they gave the she gave me.
Was it exciting for you?
Yeah. not from the Queen, you know. I received in Japan.
Oh, you received it
at the Japanese embassy.
Well, you, along with that, then you started coming out in international films, I guess. Once you made the transfer to London, and your role in The Last Samurai with Tom Cruise brought you United States recognition or worldwide recognition. I think they were all saying, who is that hero, that great-looking guy? Did you give any samurai advice when you were on the set?
Yeah, we spent a long time for the training together, and then I told him from the beginning how to grip, how to use the body, eye line, wearing the kimono.
Yeah, tie into your kimono?
Yeah, I've done everything from the beginning, like my role in the film. Yes.
And then in 2004, The Twilight Samurai that you were in was nominated for an Academy Award. Tell us about that, your character. I love that film. It was so poignant and beautiful.
Thank you. That's an unusual samurai film, you know. My role, the Seibei, is a strong sword fighter, but he want to give up to continuing samurai, you know. He doesn't want to fighting, you know. He want to be a farmer, and he loves a peaceful life with
gentle.
The children, you know. But he had the modern thought, I believe.
That was very interesting, I thought, because he was very torn, wasn't he, in his character. Mm-hmm. And another character that you played, you came out of these costumes, out of your samurai costumes and your kimonos, into this very suave, sinister guy in The White Countess.
Oh, yes.
That was a change.
1930s. Yeah, it was a big change, and then it was a big challenge. It was my first film to speak in English in the film.
You did great.
Thank you very much.
So let's talk about The Promise. That's Chen Kagi's film, terrific director.
Yeah.
And you got back into those heavy costumes again.
Yeah. Heavy armor, helmet. Not like samurai, but the heavy and hot is the same.
And you were always heavy and hot, yeah. And you were riding horses. Are you an equestrian? Did you know? Did you ride the horse yourself?
Yeah, I've learned horse riding for a long time, and I have my own horse in Japan.
This character that you play, the general, is just bigger than life. And I guess he's bigger than life because he's got so much armor on.
I know.
How did you train for that?
When I was young, I studied a lot of things about stunts, fighting, horse riding. And I've done a lot of samurai films, action films, so that's easy for me now.
What about your expressions? Those expressions of yours on the screen.
Yeah.
Can you give me one of those looks?
Yeah.
The film is about fate and destiny, the theme of it. Mm-hmm. Do you believe in that, the story, that you can change your destiny, or that you have to just stick with fate?
Yeah, I think so. We can change our destiny by myself, you know. Because we have a lot of choice, like the Queen, you know. Every moment, every minute, we have a lot of choice. Like the actor choosing the script. Which way, and which director, or which country shall I go? And then every choice will change my life, and you know, we can make our destiny by ourselves, I believe.
You're a Japanese man playing a Chinese person, I guess, in the film, or being directed by Chinese.
Yeah, directed by Chinese and Chinese film, but my role is not specific Chinese, you know, Asian role. Because the story about this sometime and somewhere in Asia.
I see.
No nationality for Japanese, Korean, Chinese, no borderline. So Asian cast, Asian role.
So many people from Asia. How did Mr. Chan?
Chan Dong-ong.
Direct you? In what language?
Yeah, we used the five languages around on set. You know, English, Chinese, and Mandarin, Cantonese, Korean, Japanese, you know.
Did you all understand each other?
Yeah, small word, we could understand.
You had the wonderful experience of working with him as a director, also with Yoji Yamada, James Ivory,
yeah.
Edward Zwick. Did they all have different styles?
Yeah, every director has different style, but basically the filmmakers this has the same spirit. So yeah, it was very smooth. And then especially the last year I worked with Danny Boyle in London. He also, you know, good creator, and then they are so helpful for me. And then, yeah, style is different, but the spirit is the same.
That was the spirit of this movie, The Promise. When you were making it, were you aware how beautiful the color was? Were you aware that there was crimson and the crimson forces against the black forces?
Yeah, I know. So this is the Asian film, but the story and the visual is universal, I believe.
Thank you very much for being with us. And thank you for watching the Joan Quinn Profiles. Keep riding to 777 South Figueroa, 44th floor, Los Angeles 90017. And we'll see you next time on the Joan Quinn Profiles.